I'd like to thank the association for inviting me to talk here today. It's an honor to share with you some of my considerations on quality in the practice of cardiac surgery in a congenital unit. The definition of quality is in itself not a straightforward one. I borrowed this definition mainly from the industry and statistical world. But all the definitions that I found, I think that the most fitting are those from W.E. Deming and Jeniki Taguchi. Because we all strive to provide to our children the best care possible, both in terms of outcomes and experience. But we also know that we need to be able to provide the same level of care to each and every one of them. And therefore, consistency and reproducibility have to be some of the main elements of our care. The debate on quality is one that is very live in every discussion in the UK, both in the surgical and non-surgical environments, and part of it stems from historic event, such as the Bristol Royal Infirmary Inquiry, which took place in the early 2000s. This referred to a series of events that demonstrated how at Bristol cardiac unit over the late 80s, early 90s, mortality was almost double than in every other unit in the UK. There was a thorough and very far-reaching inquiry as a result of that, which went through witnessing from hundreds of depositions. Almost a million pages of documents were reviewed. The medical records of around 2,000 children were scrutinized. And the result of the inquiry were damning for the unit. The unit was found to be overreaching itself, having lost contact with the development, the current development on cardiac surgery at the time. They showed that there was a profound lack of clinical leadership, lack of teamwork, which provoked the fact that a third of their children had had less than adequate cardiac surgery or care. The reasons for these failures were of different types, but included poor performance from the professional, both surgeons, nursing, the associated specialties. There were no obvious standards for evaluating performance or assessing quality of care. Communication was poor, and partly because of what was called at the time a club culture, which meant that individuals from different specialties didn't talk to each other. There were a series of recommendations as a result of this inquiry. This recommendation included improving the competence of the healthcare professionals dealing with the pediatric surgery, improving the organization of the unit and the structure of the unit, and putting in place means of monitoring of their practice. Incidentally, the questions on how to improve quality in the UK is an ongoing one, and since the early 2000s to this very day, the debate is still very alive, and we're still in the middle of a major reorganization of the congenital cardiac surgery nationwide. I should probably say that, incidentally, Bristol, in the meantime, managed to solve its issue, as is now a unit performing at the forefront of cardiac surgery in the UK and internationally. So what is there for a group of surgeons and cardiologists and all the associated specialists to do to improve continuously the quality of their practice, even without incurring in the dramatic events of Bristol? In Southampton, we looked at this from different aspects, and certainly a lot of help comes from the research, the specific research that has been published on quality control. And in this sense, a seminal paper published from the group at GOS, Great Ormond Street Hospital, in the early 2000s, has provoked since then a lot of attention. In 2000, they published a report on the practice over 230 or so neonates with transposition of great arteries and the surgery that they underwent to correct it, which at the time was the arterial switch operation, which is a rather complex operation to do. They looked at this operation performed over 16 centers across the UK by a group of surgeons. They concentrated not only in crude mortality, which is a relatively blunt instrument today to assess quality in every unit, but I look perhaps more interestingly at the occurrence of the so-called adverse event. Adverse event is anything that happens that is not expected to. It's an event that comes from outside the realm of what we would expect a course of an operation to be. It's not necessarily a clinical complication, but a series of events that could lead to one, could lead also to more serious clinical complications, such as near misses or even a fatality. They tried to link the occurrence of such events to what would be the markers of surgical behavior during the operation. In other words, they tried to draw a connection between what is the adequate behavior of a surgeon in theater and the occurrence, or the lack of it, of these adverse events. And they found that successful surgeons seem to have certain characteristics in common. They show mental strength and resilience, but at the same time, a degree of cognitive flexibility and adaptive behavior. In other words, these are surgeons that can take care of situations where they come as unexpected or sudden problems. They also found that these characteristics are best expressed in the right environment, which is one free of stress, free of distraction, and one where the group's attention is concentrated constantly on the clinical needs of the patient and nothing else. They found that the more experienced the surgeon is, the lower the number of these unexpected events. So that, as you see in this graph, on the left side, you will see the surgeons with the highest number of operations performed having the lowest number of adverse events. Like a famous surgeon in the United States who was asked how could he have such a low number of complications. He says, "I'm very lucky." And it turns out that the older I become, the luckier I get. We look at not only the research to get some insight in how we could arrange our practice to avoid or to minimize the risk of having unexpected events. In 2007, I was at a professional development course, and the key speakers were two officers from the Royal Air Force who came and talked to us about their selection criteria, in other words, about the psycho-attitudinal characteristics that the youth that they were examining should display in order to undertake their flying course. Shortly after, the Commandant General of the Royal Marines came and gave the keynote speech at the plenary session of the cardiothoracic surgery meeting in the UK. So comparison between these fields of expertise aside, the accent here is on the fact that in cardiac surgery, like in these other fields, some attention has to be put on the characteristic that the individual that performed this job need to display or are likely to display to be successful. But then the same group from Great Ormond Street took things a step forward. So instead of looking at the individual or the individuals of one subspecialty, the surgeon in this case, they look at the functioning of the group as a whole. And so they analyzed the practice of one unit over 12 months across the board, all the operations that came through that unit, from the very simple to the very complex operation. They analyzed this to a great degree of detail with external examiners, videotaping, questionnaires, and they found that across the board, the average number of unexpected events or failures, as we can all call them, is quite high. It's about 15 on average per operation. They also found that there's what we could call a sort of a background noise. In other words, in every operation which is considered successful, there is a number of events as such that occur. And these events are normally simple, inconsequential, but when they reach a critical mass, they can escalate and initiate a so-called chain reaction that can result in proper clinical complication, near miss, or fatality. they found that the majority of these events have very little to do with surgical expertise or the expertise of the person involved with the operation, that be the anesthetist or the perfusionist. Have got more to do with the organizational failures, communications, equipment failures, a lack of the personnel in theater at the time of the operation, a lack of the specific instrument or the valve, problems with the perfusion circuit, problems with the tubing. Very seldom these are related to the core of surgical decision of surgical performance. They went on and tried to also draw from other fields inspiration for proposing some solution to this. They traveled to Modena, to the Ferrari factory, and they learned from them, the way they organized their pit stop, how to organize an appropriate surgical handover, post-surgical, to the ICU. So what is the system? Why are we concentrating on the system? The system in cardiothoracic surgery unit is a unit of a group of people who work together towards a common aim. Once we establish what the aim is, which I guess in this case would be the provision of adequate and excellent cardiac surgery, every member of the group needs to be made aware of what the aim is. And certainly, for a system to function, among the aims of this system has to be also plans for the future of the system itself. In other words, the system needs to take care of itself as much as it takes care of the products, in this case, the provision of adequate cardiac surgery. Deming also found that when the focus of the system is on quality, the results, the quality can be defined as an equation whereby the result of the efforts of this system is divided by the total cost, which in this case we could consider as the complications, the mortality, the economic cost, the cost in terms of psychological and emotional damage to the families when something goes wrong. Quality tends to beget itself. And one of the mechanisms that I think I find particularly fitting in this is, again, Deming's doctrine of the so-called PDCA. Deming introduced this doctrine in engineering and statistics in the early 40s. But he postulated that every system has to constantly look at its own weaknesses. And once these weaknesses has been highlighted, it has to plan a solution, implement the solution, the do part, then check the result of the implementation or the outcomes of this implementation and act on those outcomes. When this is continuously performed on a time scale in a cycle, it creates a sort of spiral that brings the overall quality upwards. And it makes sense because the check part of the spiral, it is what happens when you verify an hypothesis, which is the one that would be in the plan or the P part, not unlike the scientific method that is applied to any other field of empiric work. So I'll try to give you some example on how we try to apply this concept in the practice of our unit. And one of the most simple thing to use in this case is the very structure of our department. At UHS, the patient, the child, or neonate, or the adult congenital, sits firmly at the center of a tight ring where the four named consultants that are responsible for that case, and that would be the surgeon, the cardiologist, the anesthetist, and the intensivist, consultant or attending, depending on how we want to call them, form the closest group of people that are responsible for the majority of the decisions that regard this patient. At any given time, one or more of these consultants would be involved with the decision. An outer circle represented by the nursing staff, the junior medical staff, the coordinators, and so on, continuously inform the work of those in the inner circle and is in reverse informed by them in a dual way communication street. And then there is an outer circle, the third one, where communication is spread horizontally. And this is where the whole group meets at MDT meetings, morning round in PICU, grand rounds, morbidity and mortality meeting, and the performance meeting, which is the one that I'm going to talk a little bit more in detail in a few minutes. What are the benefits of this system? Well, the benefit for the patient is that the people with the most experience are also the primary decision maker. So practice is controlled at all times at the highest level. But also communication is central. And perhaps even more importantly, knowledge is constantly shared thanks to these numerous meetings that we have and mutually enhanced. And this is, in my opinion, is particularly important because in units where integration is lacking, and probably Bristol was one of them at the time, where knowledge or specialistic knowledge is concentrated in the hands of few individuals, normally the attending on the consultant professionals, very little communicates through the others or to the other subspecialties, so that the shared knowledge of the group is relatively low. And any operator within this group will not have access to the great deal of shared knowledge. Whereas in a fully integrated system, where communication is going up and down, but also transversely, the shared knowledge as an average is much higher. At all times, both the experienced professional and the less experienced professionals live in the same medium of a high level of knowledge. The second example that I will bring is that of the mentoring program. Introducing a new surgeon to a surgical unit is, per definition, a system stressor. The new person will have his own background, his own characteristics, his own abilities or lack of, experience or lack of, and his own character. It will be needed a full integration of these surgeons without affecting the overall output of the unit. So I'll take the example of a surgeon who underwent this integration at UHS 5 years ago through a programmed mentorship program of 18 months divided in 3 semesters. During the first semester, all cases for these young surgeons were selected and assisted by the senior surgeons. He still performed 120 procedures. And in the second semester, the complexity score of the operations increased, but also the independent portion of his work increased. Mentoring became from a carpet type of mentoring to a case-selected mentoring. And in the third semester, the transition was almost completed to an independent practice with a higher degree of complexity and whereby assistance was more asked rather than offered. You can see in this graph, I hope the colors are clear enough, how this progressed. So you will see a grouping of different type of operations according to the RACS-1, which is a standard stratification method to score complexity of an operation. That named surgeon performed in the first 6 months in red, operation mainly in the level 1 or 2 of the RACS system. In the second semester, the blue ones in level 2 and 3, and only in the third semester he performed operation from the risk category 4. The third and last example is that of continuous monitoring of practice. Continuous monitoring is the process and technology used to detect compliance and risk issue in every system. In our unit, a system has been introducing of a surgical review activity whereby every 15 days, all the surgeries performed in the unit are presented and reviewed in a multidisciplinary broad meeting, which involves surgeons, cardiologists, anesthetists, intensivists, junior, nursing staff, and so on. It is different from other means of quality control, research or audit, because it looks at clinical complication as much as it looks at adverse events. It is a self-assessment method, so it doesn't require the intervention of external examiners for its activity to happen. It is led by clinicians who work at the forefront in the operating theater on the ward. He has virtually no extra cost for the unit. Allow the circulation of information both up and down, as I said before, because are the junior members of the team who prepare this activity, but is also horizontal because data can be processed and distributed or published. It's got a high clinical effect because once problems have been highlighted, they can be intervened upon straight away. It's got a high degree of participation and most importantly, is ongoing, is live, is continuous. So it's not an episodical review as the audit or the research work can be. It has its drawbacks and its problems. It is time consuming. And because fundamentally we find ourselves in a unit telling each other what didn't go well, it is a possible source of criticism, tension, and require a degree of maturity from the members of the unit to overcome their selflessness. But it does help to overcome some of the well-known problems in incident reporting, especially among the medical component of a unit. Doctors normally seem to display an incredible lack of time when it comes to reporting their own practice. Some of them are also worried or afraid that reporting incidents will end up in litigations or giving way to possible lawsuits. And the vast majority still struggle to understand what adverse events are, what the difference between adverse events and a complication could be, and what are we going to do with all this reporting. So what we do with this reporting is what I'm going to show now, which is how we reviewed through the surgical review meeting the mentorship program. We collected data from the preoperative status of the patient over these numerous meetings over the period of 18 months, data relating to the intraoperative course, and these were data that displayed the presence of, for instance, mismatch between the preoperative and intraoperative diagnosis, the presence of complications during the operation, whether or not the operating course was smooth or required a rerun, whether at the end of the operation there were residual lesions, what need to be done with this residual lesion, whether they need a further diagnosis of intervention. We used a few markers make sure that the consistent practice is happening, and so we make sure that every operation had an echocardiogram at the end of it, that handover was properly done for every case. And then we collected the more commonly known postoperative complications of all types. We grouped these outcomes and we called them adverse event as a whole. So when we analyzed the practice which was non-mentor, that of the senior surgeons, the one that was the habitual practice of the unit, over the 3 semesters, we found that in the 3rd semester there was a surge in this practice because then the independent practice of the newly introduced surgeon was added on to this practice. And we found that the overall average of adverse events was about 0.5 per operation. And that of near misses was about 0.05 per operation, which is fairly low. We found that the practice in the mentor activity, obviously of the junior surgeons only, was very similar to that of the non-mentor practice. And so was that of the incidence of the near misses. When we try and compare this data and analyze this data for significance, we found that as far as the mentor activity went, the mentor activity remained relatively constant in regards to the incidence of adverse events throughout the year and a half of practice. And there was no obvious increase in the incidence of adverse events despite the increase of the complexity of the operation as we saw on the previous graph. When we compare the 2 activities in the non-mentor activity, we found that the addition of the independent practice of the surgeon to that of the 2 surgeons that were already operating also didn't increase the overall number of adverse events. This was not the only effect that we could demonstrate by using the continuous monitoring of our activity. Thanks to the recognition of clusters of complication as they were happening, we were able to intervene on major surgical issues like fenestration in the Fontan operation. We revised our practice in relation to Blalock-Taussig shunt, which presented a cluster of mortality at some point. We implemented new guidelines in anticoagulation in adult congenital patients because of a few episodes of bleeding, significant bleeding, requiring reoperation after surgery. We introduced a new booklet for the junior doctors that come on board. And we changed our referral system from the peripheral hospital so that we would not see delay in referrals as we seen at the beginning. So in summary, I think the quality in every unit obviously need to look at the provision of excellent cardiac care for our children, but it also needs to consider reproducibility and the reduction of adverse events as primary goals of every effort to improve quality, whether this is an established unit or a unit that has been established. Certainly, this process requires key individuals in all subspecialties, the surgical, the cardiology, the anesthesia, and the intensive care specialty, to live and drive change and to take responsibility for declaring when things go wrong. But there are strategies that can be implemented to continuously enhance quality, and I hope that the examples that I gave today made that a little bit clear. The PCDA cycle, the sharing of knowledge, and the distribution of knowledge horizontally within the unit, and the continuous monitoring of our practice, I think are helpful tools. Thank you.